horse playing bass, but I do wonder whether there was a short period when maybe both of them were interchanging and playing bass. There's certainly this picture exists, which shows the pair of them there with both guitars. And what happened to Stuart's bass? He sold it to Klaus Voormann. You know Klaus Voormann, of course. Klaus owned the bass for some time, but then Sutcliffe's estate, his family, they claimed the bass belonged to them. Klaus tells me he didn't want any aggravation, any trouble, and he just handed the bass over to Sutcliffe's estate, who in turn, I think, sold it to the Hard Rock Cafe. So sadly, it's there now. I think it would be rather fine if it was still with Klaus Voormann, don't you?
Yeah.
Sadly, not so. But the good news is, as we speak, I'm making Klaus Voormann another Sutcliffe bass. So maybe one day we'll see Klaus with his bass. It's going to take us about a year, because we have no idea how to make it. We haven't made one for 50 years. But hey, we're going to make one for Klaus. So, finally, good, thank you. Finally, let's move on to Mr. McCartney. And I'm going to bust another myth for you in a minute. You all know Paul McCartney played violin bass, he still plays a Hofner violin bass today. He didn't actually get the name violin bass until after 1963, when it started to be sold in this country and the importers, Selmer, gave it this name, violin bass. They didn't think 501, which is our name for it in Germany, Hofner 501, they didn't think that was very sexy. So they called it the violin bass. I'm not sure that's very sexy either, do you? I think Beatle bass is better. So, which is what everybody calls it today. They all call it the Hofner Beatle bass. So, Mr. McCartney gets the job of playing bass with the Beatles. You all know this story. He gets, as he put it in his words, he got lumbered with the job and had to go and buy himself a bass. This is when all the myths and legends start about how he got this bass, but it's actually really simple. There's no myth, there's no legend about it. He went to a shop in Hamburg, number 29 Colonnade, called Steinway's Music House in Germany, in Hamburg. It wasn't so far from St. Pauli, it was a walking job. Steinway's was a first-class premier music dealer. They weren't a backstreet music shop. They weren't like Hesse's. This was a top-flight music dealer. You know Steinway's pianos? Who knows Steinway's pianos? Heard of those? These are the same people. They're in this league up here. So Paul goes into this shop looking for a bass. And I've talked to Paul about this. And he says, yeah, he remembers going in there. He remembers seeing a violin bass on the wall. And because it was symmetrical, he thought he could play it upside down. After that, he kind of forgets what happens. But if he saw it and it was symmetrical and he thought he could play it upside down, doesn't that suggest to you he saw a right-handed violin bass? Yeah? But he doesn't finish up with a right-handed one, he finishes up with a left-handed bass. And what for surely happened is Steinway's, being a premier dealer, said, no, sir, don't buy that, we'll order you a left-handed bass off the factory. And in those days, Hofner would have got that bass up to Steinway's in about 3 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks. It would have been no problem. They'd have had bodies and necks ready. They'd have cut a bass left-handed with the control panel on the other side and shipped that up to Steinway's for Paul. And the other thing that's interesting, it was the first ever left-handed violin bass that Hofner made. We'd never made one before. No others exist before the one that Paul bought to play in the cabin. So all the myths and legends about Paul and the left-handed bass and that, there was no way Paul saw a left-handed bass hanging in the shop in Hamburg. We'd never made one until Paul ordered that one. So thank you, Paul. That was the first one we made. And you'll be familiar with, there's many, many pictures of Paul playing the bass. I'll be on the right slide now. You can see the cabin bass. I can't see the slides. Okay, if you could move on please, Kath, to the next picture.
Well, that's
there's a picture there back at the cabin. He bought the bass in Germany, but never playing, I think, at the Star Club. Here he is back at the cabin. They're still with Pete Best. The rest of them have already got the famous Beatle lineup. There's Lennon with his Rickenbacker, George's clutching his Gretsch duo jet, and Paul's proudly clutching his bass. Pete Best is there helping him hold it up. So a famous picture there. If we move on one more, Kath. That's another really fantastic shot of Paul with the bass as it originally was. Now, it's now called the Cavern Bass. It didn't really get this name until the 1990s. Again, it would have just been called Hofner Violin Bass and Hofner 501. Hofner started reproducing the bass, a complete reissue in the 1990s, and it's then that he acquired the name the Cavern Bass. And it's clearly got that name from Paul's clear association with playing at the Cavern, I think. Tell me, how many times did the Beatles play there? 292. 292 times they played there. And I don't know how many times he played in the bass, but enough times for it to acquire the name of the Cavern Bass. If we move on one more, please, Kath. There's a famous picture, but anybody tell me where this was taken? Anybody know when and where that was taken? It's obviously something here in Liverpool. It's something to do with the Merseybeat paper. And again, you can see Paul with the Cavern. Anybody know where that is?
Empire Theatre. No.
Shout. No. Birkenhead. Okay, it's in Birkenhead. I know a lot about Hofner guitars, a boring amount about Hofner guitars. I'm not much of an expert on where the Beatles played and when, I'm afraid. But I guess some of you guys are. And if I get things wrong, please tell me, okay? If we go on one more, Kath. That's one of the last sightings of the bass. This is June 1963. This bass was used on all the early recordings. It was used on The Please Please Me. It was used on With the Beatles. So when next time you put either of those LPs on, what you're hearing Paul play is his first bass, the Cavern Bass. Okay? This picture's June 1963. He's going to retire this bass very soon. So that's one of the last sightings of it. What happened to it then? Well, we made him another bass. In 63. Early in 64, he had the first bass renovated, and unfortunately and very sadly, he took it to Burns Guitars in London. And they put the pickups into a different mounting. They resprayed it, dark tobacco to yellow sunburst. You can just see it in that picture there. He's holding it there. That's, I think, taken at the Let It Be sessions at Twickenham Studio. You can see the very bright colour on it. I don't know if you can see there that the pickups are mounted. They're mounted in a huge piece of ebony, black wood. They really make it into quite an ugly bass. Whatever, he hardly ever used it after that. There's one or two, I think he used it on the Revolution video, and he used it briefly at these Let It Be recordings. And then at some point from somewhere then, it got stolen. And it's never been seen since. We don't know where this bass is. When I spoke to Paul, he said he'd very much like to have it back. So if you've got it, please give it back to Paul. It's not like he hasn't done enough for you, okay? So that's Paul's first bass. In the summer of 1963, somebody, and we don't know who, because we don't have the records anymore, somebody ordered another bass for Paul. And that's the bass you see him play today. It would have been made around August, September 1963. We know that, we can tell by the electronics inside it. And it would have been delivered to him in London. Who ordered it? Brian Epstein? Did Paul order it? Nobody knows. And Paul certainly doesn't remember. He doesn't remember very much, actually. He's getting a bit old. But, if you move on to the next slide, Kath, this is the first sighting of Paul with his new bass. This is the television show, 1963 in October, I think October the 10th, 1963. Thank Your Lucky Stars. Hands up who remembers Thank Your Lucky Stars on the television. Okay, well you're older than me then, thank you. I don't remember that. I've got to be nine, so I probably had to go to bed before that was on. If You Push On, Plays Captain, the next one. This is the famous Ed Sullivan rehearsals for when they went to America in the USA in 1964. I included this picture. I'd never seen this before. Are you familiar with this picture? Any of you seen this before? There's a guy called Vince Calandra playing George. Apparently George had a sore throat, was back at the hotel, didn't attend this part of the rehearsals. And they got this guy, Vince Calandra, to stand in for George. Apparently he was a studio producer or something, and that's him. But you can clearly see Paul there with his 1963 violin bass. And if we go on again, Kev, this is the famous, you know where this is, don't you? This is Candlestick Park, their last official public live performance, 19 August 66. I think that's quite a sad picture, not because it's their last performance, but look at them. They're hemmed in, they're like animals in a pen, aren't they? To stop the fans getting at them. Isn't that a sad picture? You know, that it should have got to that they couldn't just play like everybody else. But there they are. You can prominently, quite clearly see Paul with the bass. And if we push on, please, Kev. Here's the last time that I know of that this bass was played with the Beatles live. This is, you know where this is. You don't need to tell me. For me to tell you, this is Paul, this is the last time, this is January 69. Freezing cold, and they're up on the roof. How many of you here have got own violin bass? Okay? You all own violin basses. If you form a queue later, over here, and ask very nicely, my wife will give you a bassman sticker. You know what the bassman sticker is? Okay? You can just see it on Paul's bass there, just up above his hands. He stuck up, it's actually something to do with Fender amplifiers, I'm not quite sure what, but he's got the bassman sticker on there, and I've reproduced a few. So if you've got a violin bass and you'd like one, you ask my wife, Kath, very nicely, she might let you have one. Yeah? Yeah, she's nodding her head, so you're okay, that's good. I won't bore you for much longer. I'll just move on if you would, Kath. This is Paul taken recently on tour in the USA. As I said before, this is still the original 63 bass. So I would say he doesn't make a bad guitar. You know, he's played this a few
That's
times.
Amazing, yeah. This 54 bass. Years, huh?
When I spoke to him, he said he's learning. It's not bad. He's getting used to it. He's doing good. The pick guard's gone. The only thing that's changed on this bass from its originality is it's got a new set, well, some other tuners on the top of it. But I don't think that's bad for a bass that's 50, 54 years old now, being used all over the world. Okay? So that's that. Okay, Kath? Just very briefly, the Hofner guitars that the Beatles didn't own. There's two. There's this Hofner Senator Lennon are supposed to have had, and then there's the famous presentation bass. There's a picture of the Senator. The story very briefly is that Hofner Senator, we sold in the 1960s, we sold more than 10,000 of these into the UK. Lots of them still around. If you look on eBay, you can buy Hofner Senator really easily. Sometime in the 80s, Mal Evans' wife, Lil, put this guitar up for auction, claiming that John had given it to Mal. But there's absolutely no evidence for this guitar. Nobody remembers him playing it. Ken Brown at the Quarrymen had a Hofner Senator, but John didn't. There's no photographs anywhere ever surfaced of John playing a Hofner Senator. What did happen bizarrely though is George gave a letter to Mill of authentication. I personally believe George was doing a kindness for her, because I can't find any evidence anywhere that John ever owned off the Senator. And if we go on one more time, please, Kath, to the presentation bass. Do you know the story behind this? Okay, this bass was made in 1964 by Selma. It had gold-plated hardware, and the plan was to present it to Paul McCartney. Whatever happened, the plan fell through. It wasn't presented to Paul McCartney. There is a suggestion he saw it briefly, he didn't play it, but this bass existed. It then disappears. And the next time it's surfaces. It turns up in a music shop in Luton, of all places. Who's been to Luton?
I've been.
Yeah, never mind. So it turns up that a guy called John Bunning brought it and played it in the group. Sometime later, a company called the Music Crowd from Doncaster get hold of the guitar, and they attempted to auction it as a bass owned and played by Paul McCartney. It wasn't. Paul never played this bass, Paul never owned the bass, and in Paul's own words, if I'm supposed to own this bass, give it back, it's mine, not yours. Okay, so this is the bass Paul never owned. That's that. So, I'm going to shut up. Have I bored you to death? I hope not. Anybody got any questions about Hofner? No? Yes?
I'm doing a video for YouTube.
That's right. It's now called Trekking König. König is the German word for king, so it's Trekking King. It sells sportswear now. Gentleman's absolutely right. Steinway's is the shop is still there if you're an avid Beatles fan and you want to go see everywhere the Beatles ever were in Hamburg. You need to look for Trekking König. It's a sportswear shop. Tell you what's bizarre also, sir, is I cannot find any decent pictures of Steinway's in the 1960s. Just nobody thought it was an important shop. Paul McCartney was there. And the other thing is Steinway's also are completely disinterested themselves. I've emailed Steinway's 3 times for information about that shop. They never reply. So clearly not interested. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I'm not an authority on the rest of them. I only do Beatles, Hofners.